Yeah, now it is better. So, good morning, friends. Today we will be starting the first hour again will be on Scala and Spark workshop. Let me share my screen here and let me start the recorder and then we will start the today's session. Okay. So as you guys raised some concerns about the training I have taken in the last session, as you were requesting for more hands-on approach than explaining the pre-existing example and showcasing that and asking you to execute that. Some of you guys are not getting the context. What we will do is today we'll go ahead and start on Spark, okay? And then we'll come back to Scala towards the end of the Scala and Spark workshop. And then we will do those complex examples of building simple applications using Scala as programming languages. I will be covering Scala test, connecting to the database and everything as part of one program. And I will demonstrate taking a simple example. And then I will give you a more complex example for the exercise. So let us do that way. And the amount of knowledge which you have gained is more than enough, even though you didn't finish the program. 1 minute, okay? I'm listening. Tones whenever people enter or exit. So now I removed that. We will not be hearing that noise. Okay. The knowledge of dealing with collections and writing simple Scala programs are more than enough to proceed with Spark. So far Scala we have covered, I think, four sessions, 4 hours. And then we will be covering the Spark APIs, core Spark APIs for at least the next 10 to 12 sessions. And also we have Spark SQL. So all these things will take at least another 16 hours easily, okay? And probably it might take a little bit more than 20 hours. So everything will be done within 20 to 22 hours. At max, it might extend for another hour or two, not more than 24 hours. You'll be done with Scala and Spark workshop. Okay, so today we are starting with Spark. Next 8 to 10 sessions, we'll be primarily focusing on Spark and using Scala as programming language. And once this Scala Spark workshop is done, we will be doing some of these things with Python as well. So Python is important for some of the certifications. So before getting into the details about Spark, let us evaluate the certification exams and what all are required for different certifications. Spark is the hottest tool in big data ecosystem as of today. And everyone is talking about Spark, be it Cloudera, Hortonworks, which are traditionally Hadoop distributions. They're also embracing Spark quite extensively. On top of that, there are vendors like Databricks, who is pitching Spark extensively. So they are specialized in Spark alone. Whereas vendors like Cloudera, Hortonworks, and MapR provide all the tools and technologies that are required to build enterprise scale data processing applications. So they not only cover Hadoop, Spark, they also give Scoop, Hive, and also data ingestion tools such as Kafka, Flume, et cetera. Whereas Databricks is purely Spark. They don't talk about anything else. So all these vendors, Cloudera, Hortonworks, MapR, which are traditionally Hadoop distributions, now embracing Spark. On top of it, Databricks also one of the major vendors with respect to Spark. All these four guys conduct certification exams. In this, Cloudera and Hortonworks are a scenario-based exam. So they give several scenarios, and you have to execute those scenarios by developing programs or by finishing the programs. They might give skeleton to you, and you have to update that skeleton, and you have to make sure that program execute based upon the scenario. And then MapR and Databricks, it's object to exam. They give 60 to 70 questions and you have to get 70% out of it. And there will be 60 or 70 questions, and most of them will have small Scala programs. Mapper, both Databricks use Scala as the programming language. They might give Scala programs in the middle, and you should be able to interpret those Scala programs to answer those questions correctly. So this is about exam pattern. Cloudera and Hortonworks are issue based, scenario based, whereas Mapper and Databricks are objective type of exam. So now let us review the curriculums. First, I will talk about CCA 175. Okay. This is the only exam from Cloudera which covers Spark. And in that, if you see, we have section for data ingest, which talks about Scoop and some other Hadoop related technologies such as Flume, HDFS, etc. And then there is one complete section about transform, stage, store. If you read the main objective of this category, they are saying convert a set of data values in a given format stored in HDFS. So you should be proficient to use HDFS as the file system and then process the data and write it back to HDFS again. So the data source of your processing is in HDFS, and the sink where the output has to be written will be HDFS. But the processing has to be done using Spark applications. And they test both your Scala and Python skills. So if you are preparing for this certification, you have to be proficient on both and Scala and Python as programming language. That being said, you don't need to write a complete Python or Scala program. They will give a skeleton, and there will be blanks where you have to include Spark-based APIs and fill those blanks. And then you have to run that program and store the output where it has to be stored. Instructions will be given. You have to follow those instructions and make sure the program ran successfully. That's it. You don't need to write end-to-end Scala or Python program. Even if you don't know how to write if condition, that is good enough. You can still clear the certification because the emphasis is on Spark APIs, not on Scala or Python as programming language. At the same time, because they give the code snippet from Scala or Python, you should be able to understand what that program is. You should understand the syntax and all. Then only you will be able to get context out of it, and you will be able to answer the question. So in this, they primarily emphasize on loading data from HDFS and also storing back to HDFS using Spark, joining data sets, calculate aggregates, which is average, sum, min, max, etc. Filtering data in the pursuit of cleaning up the data, and sorting and ranking the data. So these are the topics which are highlighted as part of the certification. So now if you actually get into Spark documentation, I'm trying to correlate whatever they are expecting as part of the certification with the Spark documentation, because in most of these subjective exams, they will give access to Spark documentation. And it's an open book exam. Both Cloudera and Hortonworks exams are open book exam. So you should be able to correlate and have good idea about documentation while giving the certification. And also, even in projects, depending upon the use case, you should be able to correlate with the documentation and get the information as quickly as possible. So in this case, most of you guys have joined my last session on Scoop. In Scoop, we have checked something called user guide. Because we are users to Scoop, we checked something called user guide. Here, it's more than when it comes to Spark, it's more than issuing commands. It's about building the applications. So we have to use Spark APIs and program using it to build the application. So that's why they name it as Spark programming guide. So you have to Google for it. And in this case, I'll be demonstrating on Spark 1.6. So the latest version is 2.1, but I will be primarily demonstrating on 1.6. So for that, you just say 1.6.2. And click on this. And it will take you to the programming guide. This is the overview page. CCA is on 1.2, and the cluster is on 1.6. That being said, you can safely practice an 1.6 and give the CCA exam. Only difference between 1.2 and 1.6 is data frames and Spark SQL. Both data frames and Spark SQL are out of the scope of CCA syllabus. Okay, so you don't try to write any SQL queries or data frames when you are trying to give CCA, because the syntax will not work, because the cluster which will be provided for the certification will be running 1.2. As long as you only focus on core API, core Spark API, that is more than enough. Okay, so this is about the Spark programming, Spark docs. This is the overview, which will give overview about Spark and all. And the main menu is programming guides. Okay, so here you can see quick start, Spark programming guides, Spark streaming, data frames, mllib, graphics, bezel, Sparker, etc. Okay, so here for CCA exam, only thing which you need to worry about is Spark programming guide. This Spark programming guide covers something called core Spark APIs. Okay, so there is a core API which will be discussing next 4 or 5 classes, and then there are modules on top of it. We have modules such as Spark streaming. So if you want to get data from web logs and do some analytics before loading into some target database, then we use Spark streaming, which is out of the scope from the course. And then if you have structure for the data, we can write SQL on top of it, which I will be covering after core API. And then there are modules such as machine learning, graph processing, etc. Okay, so these are modules on top of core API. If you understand core API, then you can get into these details, and you can leverage the knowledge on core APIs, and you will be able to write applications which are dependent on these modules as well. So Spark programming guide is the most important thing. You should have knowledge before exploring the other modules. If you directly get into mllib or graphics, it will look like Latin, or it will sound like Latin. Okay, so Spark programming guide is the one which is the most important for CCA. As long as you focus on this, you are good to go with respect to CCA. And here, yeah, as part of this core API, if you see this index, there is a section called transformations and actions. Okay, so the certification is purely about this section called transformations and this section called actions. So hardly there are 35 to 40 APIs. So if you know this 35 to 40 APIs, you should be able to clear the CCA certification without any issues. Spark APIs is just 5% to 10% in building the application, which has to be distributed and which has to scale. The actual complexity when it comes to developing the applications is on programming language. So you should have proficiency in the programming language when it comes to projects. Just having Spark API knowledge will not help in executing the projects. You will run all kinds of issues. You have to follow standard application development practices. You have to have good knowledge about the underlying programming languages like Scala, Python, if you want to use those for building the applications on top of Spark APIs. But for certification perspective, knowledge of this is a lot more important. But for execution of the project, it's all about your programming and application development skills. Spark API is only a minute component in the bigger picture. Okay, so as long as you know these things, you are good 100% with respect to CCA certification. With Hortonworks certification, you are good for 70%. With MapR and Databricks also, you are good up to 70%. Okay, so now let us talk about HDPCD Spark, which is Hortonworks certification of Spark. If you search for HDPCD Spark, it will give you the details. Click on this and click on this view exam objectives. So these are the objectives. So here there is a core Spark and Spark SQL. So on top of core Spark, which is this one, they are also trying to test your knowledge on this one, data frames, data sets, and SQL. Okay, so this is the additional module which is required for Hortonworks certification, and I will be covering this also. So 100% of CCA and HDFC Spark will be covered from Spark perspective. Okay, in this first in this 20 hours Scala and Spark workshop, and then with respect to other 60 hours, we'll be covering other aspects of CCA and other certifications. Okay, so here the difference between CCA certification and HDFCD certification is they don't give you the skeleton. Okay, they just give scenarios. You choose one programming language, it can be Python or Scala, and you can actually start developing the applications from the scratch. So you should have some good knowledge and confidence in developing small applications using either Scala or Python. So it tests your programming skills with the underlying programming language you have chosen. What I heard is, I didn't give this exam, but people who took the exam, from them, what I have heard is, for each question, there will be 7 questions, and for each question, you can choose the programming language of your choice, and you can execute that. So one question can be in Scala, one question can be in Python. But I'm not 100% sure on that, because I didn't give the exam, and Hortonworks also is not very clear about that information. Okay, but this is the feedback which I have got from a person who took the exam already. Okay, so we are trying to cover everything with respect to HDFCD Spark. And then I will show MAPR certification, MAPR Spark certification. And here you can see there will be 60 to 80 questions. And these are the subject areas. So they are trying to talk about Core Spark. So this is all Core Spark. This is working with data frames. Okay, monitoring the Spark applications. This also will be covered. On top of these things, they are also talking about Spark streaming and advanced Spark programming machine learning. Okay, these two are additional modules. And I'm not going to cover these two areas as part of the course. Probably Spark streaming I might cover up to some extent, but not machine learning. So even following my curriculum, whatever I'm teaching, there are scenarios people cleared this certification also. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah. Yeah. That is correct.
Okay, so all four of them, right? So in the industry perspective, which certifications were most important to for us to take
it? I'll come to that. Let me give all you about these things. Then I will emphasize on that. Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
So this is the MAPR certification. Now if you go to Databricks, this is conducted by Aureli, actually. Databricks is partnering with Aureli, and Databricks drive it, but proctored by Aureli. And here also, where is the information? Yeah. Here they are saying that you should read Learning Spark book to clear the certification. And here also, mostly the emphasis will be on the Core Spark API, and then data frames, and then Spark streaming machine learning. These four are the areas. So just by following the curriculum which I am explaining, you will be able to clear all the four certifications. But I am only covering 70 to 80% for Aureli or Databricks and MAPR certification. Okay. So you can close those gaps by preparing yourself, and you can go ahead and give the certification. Just recently, Snashish from Tawant have cleared the Databricks certification. He was my student when I actually gave classroom training in Tawant. So now coming back to this very important question of Ravindra, which certification is more important from industry perspective? So if you are new to big data and if you want to start learning, if you don't have any other certification, I will highly recommend CCA 175. Okay. The reason is, even though from Spark perspective, it is simpler exam compared to others, overall, it covers multiple technologies and it will give you confidence, and also you will understand how these things have to be integrated together to come up with application leveraging big data technologies. So if it is the first certification, I will highly recommend CCA 175 for developer community. But if you are already into big data and if you are already know all these things, and if you want to explore Spark, then more than this, either you go with HDP CD Spark certification or Databricks. Between the two, I recommend HDP CD Spark because it's more of programming, but Databricks is more reputed company from Spark perspective. So industry might give more value to Databricks exam. It is a little bit tough compared to HDP CD Spark exam, and it's objective, and it might be well recognized. Industry might well recognize Databricks certification over Hortonworks because Databricks is the one who actually started pushing Spark as a technology, and they got traction. They have their own projects and all those things. So in general, if it is about Spark, Databricks will be given top priority always. But HDP CD Spark, I didn't give the exam. Hortonworks is also one of the major vendors. Because it is subjective, I personally feel HDP CD Spark is better for developers. Nowadays, everyone is trying to get into this scenario-based exams from objective exams. So even from that perspective, I recommend HDP CD Spark. But from industry perspective, probably they might consider Databricks more than HDP CD Spark. In general, if it is your first certification, for anyone, I recommend CCA 175. Cloudera is one of the major vendors in big data. You will be knowing Scala with Spark, Spark with Scala, Spark with Python, and also you will know other technologies like Scoop, Hive, Flume, etc. And all these technologies knowledge are important to deliver a project. So I hope I answered your question, Ravindra. If you have any questions, I can clarify those things. Clarify it.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay, so now let us, so this is about certifications. So to cut the long story short, I'll be covering the 100% content from Spark perspective from both CCA 175 exam and also HDP CD Spark. And then 80%, 70 to 80% for MapR and Databricks certification. And this is very important, especially for Cloudera and Hortonworks. You become as much comfortable as possible with the documentation because it's an open book exam. You can easily explore APIs. You should know the meaning or context of those APIs, and then you will be able to develop the programs on the fly and answer the questions. Okay, so now let us start about exploring it. So first thing, what I will do, I will try to explain, I will try to write a simple word count program with Scala using command line, okay? And I will explain how it runs. And then probably next week, we will do an exercise similar to whatever I am demonstrating now. Okay, I am demonstrating word count, and I will give exercise on probably card count by suite or pip, which I have explained earlier. So I will define the problem statement, and you have to come up with the program, and you have to develop that program using Scala IDE for Eclipse first on your local system, make sure you execute and test it on your local system, build the jar file and deploy the jar file on the cluster, and you have to spend time executing the jar file, go through the whole exercise of understanding what is happening internally. Okay, you have to do that exercise. I will also explain once, and then you have to do the exercise and you have to fill certain information which I will be giving you as exercise on Monday. Okay, so now, so please stay focused and start listening to whatever I am saying. Okay, just a minute, we will start. I just want to make sure that people can listen. Okay, cool, people can listen. So someone has to go on to mute. Hello, please go on to mute. Okay, let me take care of it. Yeah, better. Okay, so now I am sorry. So again, we will I am connecting to the lab. So here, the way you can connect to the lab is you have to have the subscription. I hope everyone have the subscription. Go to labs.itvarsity.com and then click on sign in or sign up. You have to have a valid account. Once you sign up, if you're a first timer, there will be plans displayed and you have to take the plan and you have to pay the money, and then you will be able to use the lab. Okay, it has some issues. Let me see. Yeah, now I'm in the lab, and it gives the credentials to access the lab. Either, as I have demonstrated several times earlier, click on this open console. You will get the username and password from here if you have valid lab account. Click on this, paste. If you are using Windows laptop, you have to use Shift Insert, not Control V. Enter, copy, paste, and hit enter. Now you are in the lab. And also you can use PuTTY or any SSH-based tools like this. Give the username. And the host name is gw01.itvarsity.com and hit enter. It will prompt you for the password. You can copy password either from here, or you can also click on copy password here and then paste it over here. And then you are in the lab. You can use PuTTY also if you are using Windows. Now, first let us validate the data set we are trying to read. So before getting into this, unlike Hadoop, we have HDFS, which is a distributed file system, and a MapReduce, which is a distributed processing framework. We have both in Hadoop. Unlike that, in Spark, we only have distributed processing framework. There is no proprietary file system for Spark. That being said, it's not a limitation. It's a feature of Spark. The beauty of Spark is it can work with any file system. It can work with local file system or network mounted file system. It can work with S3, which is AWS based file system, cloud based file system. It can work with Azure Blob Storage, again a distributed cloud based file system. It can work with HDFS. So any file system, with most of them, it can work seamlessly. You don't need to worry about it. So as we are trying to process the data using HDFS, okay, first we have to validate that we have the data. So in this case, there is a public data set under public random text writer and hit enter. Okay, so there are these many files. It's 30 GB data. Each one is 1 GB, so there is 30 GB data. It's plain text data, and we want to use this data set and write a word count program on it. Okay. So when we are running in the distributed mode, when the Spark is being run in the distributed mode, underlying file system also should be in the distributed mode, and it has to be accessed by all the nodes in the cluster. And then we can also run Spark in local mode. So when I say Spark shell here, okay, what will happen is it will launch Spark in local mode. Okay. Let it launch, then I will explain. So here I am opening another tab. Connecting to the same node. And also on this machine, there is a public data set even locally. Okay, so you see this file. It is local, local file. So the path of this file is this one, data cards largedeck.txt. It's a local file. Whereas the earlier location which I have mentioned using Hadoop SS command, which is under public. Okay. This is HDFS file system. Okay. So we can either read the file from the local file system, or we can read file from the HDFS file system in local mode. So here somewhere it will say it is, yeah. So here you can see Spark executor ID driver on host localhost, because by default it is running in the local mode. Now if I want to read the data text file, I can give the local path. Here I'm giving the local path. The local path is data cards largedeck.txt. Okay. So so here, before getting into that, let me explain you a few things. What is this SC and what is this SQL context? Then I will run this command. When we run Spark shell, what happens? It opens Spark in Scala context. Our Scala will be the Scala will be opened, registering all the Spark-based jar files. Okay, so I ran Spark shell here. Okay, I ran Spark shell here, and if you scroll down, first what it is trying to do is it is creating a Spark context, which means there will be a web server which will be running supporting this session. Okay, and the object name of type Spark context is SC. Okay, we'll test that whether it is created properly or not. And then if you scroll down, there are some exceptions. Here it is complaining about address already in use. By default, when Spark shell is launched, it will try to start the web service with 4040 as port number. If there are multiple people who are trying to launch Spark shell simultaneously to run any Spark programs, it will try to reuse, it will complain that address is already in use. So every time it will retry with a new port number. So 4040, after that it tried with 4041. Oh no, it is not recording, but it is in YouTube. Sorry, I forgot. Anyway, that's fine. The video will be in YouTube. You can have a look at it later. And I will try to download from YouTube and try to make it available for you. Okay, forget about it. I will start recording the next session without forgetting. Okay. So here, yeah, go ahead. Yes, yes. This is being streamed now. Yes, yes. You can always refer. Okay. I will give you the playlist link. You just go to that playlist link. Okay. I will give it right away. So this is the playlist. Okay, big data workshop live training. As of now, this video is being recorded and it is not added. After this session is done, I will add the to this playlist, but it is being recorded. Okay, so here I am giving you the link. You can follow this link. Today's session is Scala and Spark workshop 5. I will update. I'm just giving index here. After the session, I will update what I have covered in that session so that you can easily refer. Okay. This is because 4040 is already in use. For this session, it has started the web service at port number 4041. Okay, so whenever you see these exceptions, you need to make sure to understand the side effect of that exception. So what happens is a lot of people, they launch it, they will not watch what is going on, and then they will directly start writing the programs, and then it will complain with some generic exception, and then they will raise the issue without getting the context, and it will waste everybody's time. So first you need to go through these. This is stack like Java exception. So you have to go to the first message, what it's doing, and you have to understand the effect of it. And most of the, if you do that, your questions will be answered automatically. You will not even raise the issue. Now, if I scroll down here, you can say, after the web service is started, then the Spark context object is created. Now it is saying Spark context is available as SC. Okay. On top of it, to run Hive queries, it is creating to run SQL queries in Spark. It is also creating additional contexts like SQL context. So using this, you can actually run SQL queries also. We will cover that a little bit later when we talk about data frames, Spark SQL, etc. So here, first thing before writing any command, what you have to do, you need to make sure that SC context object, SC object is created without any issues. So this is an implicit variable which is created when we launch the Spark shell. It is the behavior of the Spark shell. Okay. So now you can see there is a object of type this one, arg.apache.spark.spark context. This is the child class of this, and it, what it is saying is it is of type Spark context. Okay. Once it is done, now you can write the applications using the APIs of it. So here you can type SC dot and hit a tab. It will provide many APIs. Okay. So here we are trying to read the data. To read the data, there are multiple APIs. For now, we will just focus on text file. Text file is to read text data. So both the files, which is under random text writer, it is mostly text data, and also logitech.txt is of type text. So we can use sc.txt file to read this, to read the data from these files. So you need to understand the behavior of this text file. So if I say text file and pass a text file to it, each new line character or each line separated by new line character is considered as one record. That is the behavior of text file. Okay. And then it will create something called RDD. What is RDD? I will cover a little bit later. For now, let us try reading the files, and then we will get into RDD and other important concepts a little bit later. Okay. So here we have two file systems. One is local file system, other one is HDFS. So what we have in HDFS, this is HDFS. Random text writer is HDFS, and this is local file system, which is there on this host itself. Okay. And then there could be S3, there could be Azure Blob, it could be any file system. At any point in time, you can configure your Spark environment pointing to one type of file system. Either it can point to HDFS by default, or it can point to local file system file by default, or it can point to S3, or it can point to Azure Blob Storage. You cannot make it pointing to multiple file systems at any point in time. You can only point point to one type of file system. As I have Spark on this Hortonworks cluster, a Hortonworks based cluster, by default, Spark is configured to work with HDFS. Okay, so when dealing with HDFS, you don't need to specify the protocol. So now if I have to read the data from public random text writer and give the, here I'm giving one file name, part -m-0000, that is the one of the files here. So this is the one which I have given and I close it. So here we don't need to tell that this is HDFS because we set up using Hortonworks and they are automatically integrated. Okay, now if I want to preview the data, there is a command called, or there is an action called take, and I can say five, and it will only get five records from that, from the top, from the header. And then you can say for each println. I will explain why we are using for each and all a little bit later, but I'm just showing about how to read data from file system. Now if I hit enter, it read the data from that file and it displayed first five lines. Okay, this is the content in first five lines. Okay, some people might get confused, think that this is one line, this entire stuff is one line, but that is not the case. If I double click, so you can see that it has selected from here to here. So this is one line. Okay, so it has displayed five lines from that file. Okay, and each line is separated by new line character. Okay, so now it is integrated with HDFS, so it reads from HDFS directly. So to read from HDFS, we can also say, we can also use HDFS protocol. Okay, so when you specify HDFS protocol, you have to tell where your name node is. So if you recollect HDFS, your data will be stored in worker nodes. Okay, and your metadata will be there in name node. Name node is the master process which will be keep monitoring where your files are or where your blocks related to files are. So you have to give your name node IP address along with the protocol. So our name node, how to get our name node? You can go to Ambari. All you guys have access to Ambari. Okay. And you can actually say gw01.itvarsity.com colon 8080. There are multiple ways to actually get the details. I am showing you using Ambari, and also I will show you how to get it from the command line as well. So here we are talking about HDFS. Click on HDFS, and we are talking about name node. You click on name node, and this is the IP address. But you need port number also, okay? So if you want port number as well, instead of clicking on name node here, go to configs. And then search for the parameter called fs.defaultfs. So this is your name node IP address, and HDFS is the protocol. So if you want to give the protocol, you have to, okay, and then give the path in HDFS. So path in HDFS starts with slash, and public is the base directory, then random text writer, then your file name. Okay, and then hit enter. Now also it displayed those file lines only. So both are same. Because our Spark is integrated with the HDFS running on this, because we set up Hortonworks and Spark and Hadoop both are set up in one shot and integration is automatic. By default, it will try to get the files from HDFS. We don't need to specify this name node, IP address, and port number. If you want to get the same information from command line, yes, go ahead. No. So worker node, you have files, the actual blocks,
whole data
in the form of blocks. Okay, the blocks are nothing but physical files on the worker nodes. And then when we run HDFS FSEK, what we got? We got the related blocks to that file are all the files that are under the path which we have specified. and the location of that block, etc. So that is called as metadata of your files. And that metadata is stored in name node. So HDFS FSCK is actually getting data from name node, which is nothing but metadata of your files.
Oh, so it is getting data from name node. So in the worker node, right?
Yeah. No. So this is actually file. This is actual file. Yeah. So let me run the HDFS FSCK command on one of the files and you will understand. So here I have to give the path files blocks location. So this is the actual file name. Okay. And then hit enter. So I gave the file name itself. If I give path, it will give the similar information for each and every file under that directory. If I just say public random text writer, for each and every file, it will show the metadata. So here I gave only one file, okay? It's a 1 GB. Yes. Yes, that is correct, yeah. Okay, now we have so this is not required if HDFS and Spark are integrated. If HDFS and Spark are not integrated, then you have to specify the protocol, the name node IP address and port number. You can also get that information from files which are on the from configuration files on the gateway node. The configuration files will be under this location. It's a standard location, etc, Hadoop, conf. Here, you will see bunch of XML files, okay? And CoreSite.xml file is the one which will have your name node IP address and port number. So you can actually say view CoreSite.xml, and here you can see there's a parameter called fs.defaultfs, which have the name node URI, okay? So the same thing, we got it here. By going to configs of the service which we are interested in, which is HDFS for our purpose, I search it for fs.defaultfs, and this is the URI. Okay. So now, if I want to that is correct. You don't need to give name node URL. Even if you have to give, you can go to the CoreSite.xml. And you will get the default FS. Most likely, you don't need to give. Okay. So now, let us understand how to access other files from other file systems other than HDFS. For that, I will be trying to read data from this location. Data, cards. There's a logjack.txt. This is a local file system. It is not in HDFS. For that, let us validate whether there is a file with that name in HDFS under the same location. If I run Hadoop fs-ls data cards, it is complaining no such file or directory. Now, if I say fc.txt file and give data cards logjack.txt, this is in local file system, but not in HDFS. And here, if you just type up to that and hit enter, it will not fail. It will just create something called DAG in the backend. And until it execute, it will not fail. At this time, it is not executed. So it will not fail. It will just register, OK, I have to read the data from this location later. And when we actually write commands such as take phi, and then if you want to do further processing, this is called as action take. I will explain a little bit later. Don't worry too much about it. For now, to validate, just I'm trying to preview first five records and then looping through and print, trying to print. Now you see it is complaining input path doesn't exist because it is yes. So now how to read from local file system? You have to use file protocol. significance of the URIs and protocols, when you should specify, when you should not specify while reading the files. You should not directly go away and write a complex program, and after that, when it runs, it will fail. And if you delay identifying the issue, it will exponentially increase the stress, especially when you trying to execute something in time-bound manner, it will exponentially increase the stress. So you have to validate after each and every step, unless and until you have crystal clear about what is happening behind the scenes. Okay, so now we are able to read from both local file system as well as HDFS by launching Spark Shell in local mode. Okay, by default, the Spark configurations say when I just launch Spark Shell in Scala context, then run using local mode. Okay, and using local mode, we have validated both. Now, if I want to run in YARN mode, YARN means run in distributed mode, run on multiple nodes in the cluster rather than running using one node the way it has ran earlier. Now I want to run in distributed mode. Okay, for that I have to say hyphen hyphen master YARN client. Okay, already this gateway node know where our YARN cluster is, hence it automatically try to connect to that YARN, and it will try to launch in distributed mode. And if I hit enter now, instead of using local mode, it will now create in a distributed mode. Okay. And you can see there is a tracking URL. You didn't get all this information earlier. Now it got. You got this tracking URL. Okay. You can actually go to your browser, paste this URL, and you can see what is happening in this session. So so far we just launched the session. We haven't run any programs. That's why it is not showing anything over here. So now, once this is done, let us first try reading it from the local file system. Okay, so this is how we have to read it from the local file system. If I hit enter, it failed, because we are now running in the distributed mode. We will not be able to read it from the local file system, because that local file system is only on one node called gateway node. On the other nodes, this file system is not accessible. So you cannot actually use local file system when you are running in distributed mode. You have to either use distributed file systems like HDFS or the cloud storage like S3 blob, because all the nodes can connect to that server using cloud credentials, or you can actually set up HTTPFS. So you can actually have file system provided by the HTTP server, HTTP web service, and HTTP web service. You can use that also. But pure local file system, which is mounted only onto one host, you will not be able to access. Okay. But now if I want to run this one, either with name node URI or without name node URI, it will work without any issues. Okay. So you should know this difference. Otherwise, it can cause some confusion, especially when you are writing the certification. Okay. So now we understood how to read using different file systems. If it is S3, S3 is a cloud storage provided by AWS. You have to give credentials. There is something called access key and secret key for S3. You have to set the parameters associated with it so that our nodes in the cluster can actually connect to S3 and start processing the data from there. It is pretty straightforward. You just go ahead and check the example, and you can easily follow. Similar is the case with Azure Blob Storage or any storage which can be accessible from multiple nodes in the cluster if it is supported by HDFS APIs. Spark also supports without any issues. Okay, so any questions here about how to read files from the file system? Okay, so now we are almost towards the end of the session. We will stop here. If you have any questions, let me know. So far today, what we have covered? We have covered what is relevant for the certifications, which curriculum is relevant for the certification, how to access the documentation. And then we logged into the cluster and we understood how to read files from local file system as well as HDFS file system. And also I have shown how to access or how to launch Spark Shell in local mode as well as in the distributed mode. For distributed mode, you have to say --- master yarn client. And also we have seen how to read text files. And if we have to write word count program, we need to understand a few APIs. We need to understand how this execute and all those things. And I will take care as part of the Monday session. So probably Monday session also will take enough time to understand the theory aspect of it and going through internals. And then Tuesday or Wednesday, you will be doing exercise. Okay. And I will make sure that you understand the entire flow about how to troubleshoot the issues. Not only just understanding the APIs, but the entire execution cycle, everything will be explained in detail so that everyone have understanding in details to troubleshoot the issues as well. Not only from syntax and semantic issues, but also from performance issues. If you want to compare which one is performing better and all those things, everything will be taken care in next one or two sessions, and then you will be doing exercise to prove that you understood that. Okay, so 2 more minutes. If you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, we'll get on to the next session. We are talking about Scoop. We will continue discussing on that. So people who are on Hangout, stay tuned. We'll be starting a Scoop session within a couple of minutes. And you can connect that. If you need subscription for the lab, please go to labs.itversity.com and sign up for the lab. Pay for the subscription. It's $14.95 for 31 days, $34.95 for 93 days, and $54.95 for 185 days. And you can practice all the big data technologies. And also, we are planning to reinvest at least 20 to 25% of the lab revenue in expanding the cluster. We will provide multiple distributions. We will provide Cassandra, MongoDB, many other technologies on the lab. So over a period of time, the lab will be much more sophisticated. If you have to learn big data, you just have to come onto our platform, sign up for the lab, and you should be able to practice as a developer. That being said, we will catch up in 2 minutes. Thank you. Bye.